Good morning, everybody. We're so glad you're here in person. People are here. Let's stand up together.
One star burns in the darkness, shines with a promise, Emmanuel. One child born in the stillness, living within us, Emmanuel.
Sing it.
We're singing.
Be seated. It's good to see people back. Special thanks to those folks who are working the cameras for us, especially over the past few weeks, that we could continue to have service in your household or like in this case, we're recording it. So for those of you watching later, we're glad that you're watching. And again, we're just thankful to everybody who was able to help us continue to bring service to you even though we're adapting and adjusting like always, right?
I think there are extra jewels in the crown for Hugh when he gets to heaven. I'm just saying, give it up for Hugh. Come on.
Yes, yeah. Yes. I never thought about that. Extra jewels in the crown. That's
know.
Nice.
I don't know.
We have just a few announcements for you today. One, we have been talking about this for a little while, and I know I talked about it, and then we went virtual, and then we're talking about it again. So gift cards, we're still collecting them. You're welcome to bring them up and put them physically in the basket. I know a lot of people did that in the earlier service, and so we welcome those. Please mail them in as well. Bring them anytime. We are using those throughout the year. So those gift cards are what we use throughout the year when somebody says, hey, I have a need for this, and we are able to share and help others. So it's not just, I think sometimes it's easy to think, oh, it's just during the Christmas season, but that's not the only time that we're using those. We also are very grateful that everybody made their reservations for Christmas Eve service. We are now full. So both service times are full, which is good news and bad news. The good news is that it's going to be as packed as we can be, yeah. Right? But so it's going to be awesome. But the bad news is that if you didn't reserve a spot, we are now unable to do that, right? So, but the good news for that is we have live stream at 5. So please make sure that you join live stream. Do they need anything if they're live streaming?
Just a Facebook account.
Okay. That's yeah. It. Not like a candle
and
or anything.
Your own candle from home if
okay.
you like.
Yeah. Get a candle. Get candles ready. But that'll be at 5:00 Christmas Eve, Thursday evening. So be ready for that. We're really excited. We also just want to remind everybody that we continue to do things through social media. So we have all kinds of ways that you can connect through social media, especially Facebook. But there are other things that you can do as well. We are having daily Next Chapter chats, and there's a Christmas edition. I know I saw one with Angie Reese, so that was really good. How many of you are watching those? Okay, excellent. So keep watching those. We're going to keep doing them up until Christmas. Yeah, right on. And then we'll come up with something else. Yeah, something else that'll be exciting and engaging as we move from 2020 into 2021, which we're all excited about, right? Yes, okay, good. So having said all of that, I'm going to go ahead and just remind you with offering. We are still collecting offering. We're just doing it a little bit differently than we used to do. So we have the ability to mail in some offering, the app, our physical Dropbox, and then online. So please consider that, especially as we get into the year-end giving and how you might be able to pay forward physically your treasures, and then also just how you can bless everybody else with your talents and time as well. And I'll lead us into prayer as we continue to worship on this beautiful week leading up to Christmas. Father God, thank you so much for constantly being a presence in our lives. Whether we recognize that every moment or not, we know that you are there. You are Emmanuel. You are with us always. Oftentimes our bodies feel weary and we know we need to rest. We know we need to recover. We know we need to eat. But sometimes we forget that our soul needs that just as much. And the only way that we can rest and recover and replenish our soul is through you. So we think about everything that you bring to our lives and how much we need you. And just remind us of that this week, that even though sometimes things get a little crazy with the holiday season, it's very important to find that comfort and rest as you are with us always. And we just need to focus inward and rely on you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand back up together.
Thank you.
give him all the glory. Spots this morning. Some of us are excited about Christmas. Some of us are kind of dreading Christmas in many ways, and some of us are wondering where the magic and the mystery of Christmas is. And I just want to take a second to rest in God's presence and just think about the goodness of His glory, His sovereignty, and His majesty. We're going to sing this simple chorus again, but we're going to make it personal. For you alone are worthy. Let's sing it out to God.
For you alone are worthy. For you alone are worthy. For you alone are worthy. Nothing compares to you, nothing compares to your presence, God. Nothing can satisfy like your presence,
for you alone.
For you alone are worthy. For you.
Father, we ask that as we continue to move headfirst into the Christmas week, that everything that is a distraction from the goodness of your presence, as wonderful as it is, would melt away. And in fresh ways, whether it is gifts and Santa or relatives, whatever it is, that in some way those things would point to the goodness of your glory, would point to the reality of you and your Son Jesus in our lives. You are worthy of all the praise and all the glory. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Good morning, everybody. Merry Christmas. Dale, good morning, you little ray of sunshine. And no need to talk. Let me just tell you. Hey, good to see everybody this morning. As we were singing that even first service too, in this service, I was getting the vision of almost one by one, all of us, whatever jewels we might get in our crown, taking our crowns and one by one going before the throne of God and just bowing down and laying our crowns there and just worshiping God. And I have a feeling that all the stuff that we are on short supply of right now, maybe you're in a little short supply of feeling accepted or feeling loved or feeling full intimacy or feeling whatever it may be. As we stand before God, as we get closer in the line to God, all that stuff will be fulfilled inside of us. The longing to be loved, the longing to be accepted, the longing to see someone to see us who we really are. It will all be filled as we stand there, standing before God. And there's no one who deserves our praise and adoration than this God. And so I'm thankful to celebrate this Christmas Sunday with you all. And it has definitely been a weird, weird year. And who knows what 2021 will hold. I hope it's better in a lot of the circumstances. But even if not, we will go forward knowing that God alone is worthy. There was Brent, and I did this every time. In the very first song we did, Glory, was Glory the first one? Oh, yeah, in the bridge. I love these words. They stuck out to me. His love is strong enough. Do not be afraid. That was what it was. Do not be afraid. His love is strong enough to save us. Nothing stands in the way. Do not be afraid. His love is strong enough to save us. Nothing stands in the way. His love is strong enough to lead us. That is powerful. Do not be afraid. There's nothing that can stand in the way in the love of God. I know it feels like it. It feels like it in my life a lot of times. Like, oh, there's a lot of things that stand in the way of the love of God. I don't see God. I don't experience God. I don't feel God. I don't think God's up to anything. But I love that we can trust this and we don't have to be afraid, for God's love is strong enough to save us. Steve, I hope I didn't mess your pile up here, buddy. But just hold on to that this Christmas season. Let's pray, and then we're going to look at the last sermon on this Waiting on God series. We're going to be talking about the silence. The silence. So let's pray. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for those that are here in attendance and those who will be watching this on video in some way. And God, we thank you that you are strong enough. Your love is strong enough to reach us wherever we hear this, whatever we may be doing. Father, I pray that we would truly get a hold and have faith to know that we do not need to fear and nothing can stand in your way. Nothing can stand in your way of loving us and loving this world. And thank you that Christmas shows us who you are and that your death and resurrection prove that you have overcome sin and death and all the nastiness that tries to bring us down. Father, until the day that we stand face to face with you, worshiping you, may we continue to get as much as your presence and your glory and experience as much as we can as human beings this side of eternity. And we look forward to the day we see you face to face. So until that day, continue to give us strength and power and faith, not just so we can live lives that are nice and comfortable, but that we can continue to spread your love and build your kingdom while we live on this earth. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen. Good to be with you again. And I kind of polled the first service. How many of you are totally ready for Christmas morning? You're totally every gift. Rylan is. Look at that. Oh, my bonus son. I knew some of you would be. And I mean that as a compliment. I don't mean that. Because I tend to wait till last minute. Jen has done great getting most of all of our stuff together. And how many of you still at least one more? You got at least one more store to go to. Anybody still has to go shopping for the first time this season? We won't talk about that. But with all that stuff, it is funny because Christmas, Christmas is inevitable. It is going to happen. And Jen and I were talking, and I love that this is my favorite season of the year. But all the stress of it and the hustle and bustle and going out and getting stuff and trying to figure out gifts, all that can kind of take the joy away a little bit sometimes. But I love this time of year. But there's certainly anxieties and pains and pressures that come along with it. And we're going to talk about some of that this morning. Just a little funny to get us started. I think it's a little funny. Maybe a little funny is the key word. It's a little funny. But I read about a man who decided this year he's not going to go through all the anxiety of trying to get Christmas cards filled out and sent out. So he's like, you know what, this year I'm not going to send Christmas cards. I'm just going to take it easy. Well, as the days approached and got closer to Christmas, and he got more cards from families and friends, then you know how it goes. He starts to feel guilty, like, well, maybe I should send some Christmas cards. So he runs out to the store. There's only like one pack of cards left. He gets that pack or packs, like 40 of them, buys them, goes home. He fills them out, writes stuff in there, seals them, envelopes them, takes them to the post office so they would be delivered by Christmas, and he's feeling good about it. And he goes home, and he thought, you know what? I didn't even read what was inside the card. Let me read on one of the leftover cards. And inside the card it said, this cheery card is just to say a gift from me is on the way. So he has 40 more gifts to give now. So right when you think you're doing good, you're like, oh, it's now Christmas is still coming. And I think there are parts to Christmas that are more on the dark side. Not that we won't hang out there, but I think it's true. And so we need to look at what is it? What is it that sometimes causes us to not be joyful during the season? Interesting, in a poll that was done, 45% of Americans say they would rather just skip Christmas altogether. In other words, 50% of Americans say, I wish it could just go from Thanksgiving to New Year's Day, which I thought was a pretty large amount. And I told the first service, it feels like this, between Thanksgiving and Christmas, flew by this year. I don't know if it felt like that to you, but it feels like it's usually a little longer, but it flew by this year. But it makes you wonder, well, why do almost half of the people in our country wish Christmas would just pass us by? And I don't think that it's because, there's more family drama, although there may be more family drama during the holidays. But throughout the year, you can have family drama. I don't think it's because it's the busyness, because during the year, it can be busy. I think some of those things can contribute to it, but I think it's something deeper. I think it's something deeper in all of us that's below the surface that we like to try to push down, and that something deeper is the silence. We don't like not knowing when something's going to happen or take place or change. There's this silence. I'm not talking about physical silence or audible silence. I'm talking about the sense of God's silence in our lives. Some of you may have hopes this past year, with a goofy year that it was, maybe hopes that were not met or disappointment, or maybe there was a job or a relationship or a loved one that something's changed, you've lost them, you're in a conflict, maybe it's a difficult circumstance. And I think that's why Christmas can be a deep time of year, because it leaves us wondering with this profound question, God, are you really there? And I know there's a lot going on with all of us right now. The whole year has been weird, and it kind of leaves the question, God, what are you doing? Are you there? Are you listening? Do you really care? Do you really know what's going on in my life? And that's the kind of silence I want to talk about. When we ask God, when we pray, and nothing seems to be getting any better. Matter of fact, a lot of times it seems like it's getting worse. God's silence. We've been in the series on waiting on God, and we said nobody likes to wait. I don't love, but it makes me laugh when I get to practice what I preach on Sundays. So this past Thursday, now that I live in Ohio, I'm still, you can take the boy out of Kentucky, but you can't take the Kentucky out of the boy. Yeah. All right, but so now that I'm in Ohio, I'm getting my license plates changed. Well, I was at the DMV, the Ohio Bureau of Motor Vehicles. By the time I waited and got my plates and license, 2.5 hours, no joke, that's not even exaggerating, 2.5 hours. And as I was sitting there, there was a point I'm like, okay, this is ridiculous. And the first three people, when I got there, they were up there for no joke, because after a while, I'm like, I'm just going to time this. The same three people were in the same three windows for 45 minutes. And I wanted to go up there and just say, I would never do it. But I was like, oh, Rob, there you go, big boy. Just be patient. Enjoy God's presence in the line, like you've been encouraging everybody. And so what's interesting is nobody likes to wait, but we find ourselves waiting like that. But it's interesting, research shows that it's not really how long you wait, because if people know how long they have to wait, it's actually bearable. It's actually tolerable. So the pain is not necessarily in waiting. The pain is not knowing how long you have to wait. That's the pain. And that's true in life, isn't it? You're going through a tough, I remember a couple of my girls went through tough middle school years. And there's no sign that says, hey, when you get to be 21, it's going to be a lot better. Or it's going to be a lot worse. I don't know. You just have to wait. The pain is not in the waiting. The pain is not knowing. I don't know how long this is going to go on. I don't know how long I'm going to have to carry this suffering or this pain or this pit in my stomach or this relationship with my parents or my siblings that I want to reconcile so bad, but it just keeps getting worse. How much longer do I have to wait? That's where the pain is. That's why we were at Kohl's last night, and there's little signs along the way. You're 10 minutes from the register. And then it says, it might seem longer because of social distancing. And, you know, again, Disney World, Kings Island, they get this. As long as you know how long you got to wait, we can make it bearable. But that's not how life works, is it? Life does not work that way. The real pain is not knowing how long. So for some of us, not that my older girls are ready to be married, but Taylor's 25, Maddie's 23. And for sometimes you do wonder like, huh, I wonder when I might meet that certain someone, that person that I might marry. For some of us, if there was a sign that said, hey, 3 years from now, you're going to get married. Huh, it would take the pain out of it, wouldn't it? Or whatever it may be, if we just kind of knew how much longer we had. That's where the real pain is. The psalmist put it this way. I love that in the Bible they had these same questions. We looked at this passage the first Sunday of the series, Psalm chapter 6, verse 3. The psalmist was saying, my soul is in deep anguish. How long, Lord? How long? How many of you have had that prayer? I have had that prayer. God, how long do I have to go through this relationship? How long must I put up with this? How long is it going to take before you heal me? How long? And the psalmist had that same prayer, because there's no countdown clock in life. And there's no way to know when or if things are going to change. Sometimes there's just silence. And that silence impacts us. And we for some reason, we have a unique, we tend to misinterpret the silence a lot. There was a story I read about a woman who lost her newborn baby giving birth. And that's always a tragedy. It's never something that's easy, but it made it even more tragic in her situation because her and her husband could not have, it was very unlikely they were going to have kids after many years of trying. Very unlikely. So they get pregnant and things are going well. And they call this is our miracle. This is our miracle baby. And they're so excited and they're so in love and they're so excited about God's faithfulness. And they're talking about God's faithfulness. And when she gets in the delivery, she lost her child. And according to her, God went silent. There was now no new miracle. There was no immediate relief. There was no sign of change on the horizon. It just changed her. And listen to how she described what happened to her faith along the way. She said, I used to be a fired up Christian who poured herself into her faith, but now I feel nothing toward God. My husband and I used to be so close, but now we're almost strangers. Church used to seem so exciting, but now it bores me to death. I used to love to read the Bible and pray, but now I find it both laborious and aggravating. I just feel dead. These are the stories behind Christmas. Some of you, this is your story. I don't know if it's anybody in here. Probably are some. Definitely some that might be watching this on video. But these are the stories behind Christmas that have us wondering, like, God, I don't know. I just don't know that you're there. I don't feel you. Things are changing in my life. Maybe you're going through the silence right now. Maybe your story's not like her, but you feel the tension. You know the tension in life. There's a character in the Bible, his name's Job, and he lost everything. He lost his health, he lost his family, he lost his livelihood. And he says this, he's calling out to God in Job chapter 30, verse 20. He says, I cry out to you, God, but you do not answer. I stand up, but you just merely look at me. Have you ever felt that way? Sometimes when I'm talking to Jen, or maybe when you're talking to your spouse, I'm just going on and on, and she just looks at me. I'm like, well, say something. What do you want? And I think that's Job's looking at God saying, God, I keep praying. I'm crying out to you, and all you do is just sit there and look at me. He says, I need to know, what are you doing? Why are you silent? But the thing, one of the things I love about the Christmas story is that the Christmas story, the context of baby Jesus coming is through a season of silence. Many of you know the Bible's broken up into the Old Testament and the New Testament. The last book of the Old Testament, come on you little Bible scholars, what's the last book of the Old Testament? That's right, Malachi. Some of you said it. Or of one pastor I heard say the Italian prophet Malachi. Oh, that's always made me laugh. Malachi. But Malachi is what? Malachi, and then the first book of the New Testament is Matthew. Good. Between Matthew between Malachi and Matthew, that one flip of the page, that one page is 400 years of silence. So people are living in silence. There was no new word from God. There was no new revelation. There was nothing going on but silence for 400 years. No scriptures were inspired. And I wonder how many times the people of God asked, God, where are you? God, what are you doing? God, why aren't you answering our prayers? Are you going to answer? This is the context of Christmas. And so the Christmas story isn't about one sweet song. It's not about just one silent night. It's about 400 years of silent nights that Jesus comes onto the scene. And it's in the context of the silence and the darkness and the doubt and the questions, something happened. What happens one night. After 400 years of God seemingly just being silent, something happens. Luke chapter 2, verse 8 says this, and there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. It was just an ordinary night. It's another silent, another, just tack on another night of 400 years, nights of nights. It was just an ordinary night, but something happened this night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. Now, I know they were terrified because the glory of the Lord, but God hadn't spoken in 400 years either, so I'm sure that was part of it too. They were afraid. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. This news, God has been silent for over 400 years, but this news, it's not going to just break the silence. This news is going to be for everybody. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah of the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. It's good news because it actually tells us what God is doing in the silence. It's good news for a lot of reasons. But I think one truth that I learned years ago that I've mentioned before is the Christmas story tells us that God's silence does not mean God is absent. And I think that's such a huge truth for us in our lives. Because when we feel God being silent, when we feel God not answering prayers, when we feel God not changing our circumstances, our situations, we kind of assume, God, where are you? Why are you silent? Why are you spending your time with all the good people? And we think God is silent, but in God's silence, it does not mean that God is absent. The reason we know this is because the angel said, this will be the sign. This will be the sign, the angel says. And that's loaded with biblical language because some 700 years before that, the prophet Isaiah would say this exact same thing to this, to the nation of Israel. The prophet Isaiah would say, hey, wherever you go in the years ahead, whatever, wherever life takes you, whatever circumstance you're going to get into over these next hundreds of years, know this in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give a birth to a son and will be called Emmanuel, which we know Emmanuel means God with us. Isaiah was trying to tell him 700 years ago, wherever you go, you're going to go into some rough times. You might go into some really dark times, some really doubtful times, but this will be a sign that God is not absent. God has never left you. God is with you. I love that Christmas really doesn't tell us anything new about the character of God, but affirms the character of God, that God is with you. And that's such a powerful phrase that I want to kind of almost look at everybody and just say, wherever you find yourself this Christmas season, just know that God is with you. He's with you. He's not left you. He's not absent from you. He's with you. Some of us, at times, we want to write God off. God kind of seems like the absent landlord. You know, the absent landlord, he's always around when you don't want him to be, but he's never around when you need him to be. Some of us write God off because we feel like God is like that. God, when I need you, where? You're never around when I need you. Some of us have been carrying around pain and heartache, and it just seems like there's no end to it. But the angel tells us a different story, that Jesus comes to remind us in our darkness, in our doubts, in our situations, that God is still Emmanuel. He's still the God who is with us. And I love that in the silence, there's something bigger going on than we even can comprehend. Christmas reminds us that God is always at work, even if we can't see it, but he's going to show up when we least expect it. That seems to be the way that God works. I read the story of a pastor was talking about, a friend of his told him the story about a woman named Carol. And in Carol's life, in the span of just 2 years, she had lost two really close friends to suicide. As many of you know, when you see loved ones or friends go through such a terrible time of suffering, it does, it affects you and it impacts you. And so she was feeling really lonely and really down and full of grief. And so she was just praying. She's like, God, help me to help someone in some way. Help me to do something for folks before they get to that point. Just help me. Use me in some way, God. A few weeks later, Carol was making a phone call, and she actually dialed the wrong number. And it was someone that was on the far East Coast. And so the woman who answered sounded a little distraught. So Carol spent a few minutes with her on the phone, and she didn't really think much about it, but the woman on the other line, her name was Sue, and Sue said, hey, can we talk again sometime? Just a wrong number. And Sue said, can we talk again sometime? And Carol said, sure. And so they did. So they talked the next week, and they talked the next week, and they talked the following week. They talked about their life, they talked about work, they talked about family, they talked about their doubts, they talked about faith. Eventually, Carol was able to share her faith with in Jesus with Sue. Well, a year later goes by, and Carol had a business trip on the East Coast. So she thought, you know what, I'm going to see if Sue is available. We've just been talking on the phone, but I'm going to meet her face to face. So they go out to dinner, and Sue said, Carol, I want to tell you a story that I've never told anyone before. And so she said, a year before your wrong call, she goes, I was so lonely and so depressed that I wanted to commit suicide. And so I got in my car to drive to a bridge, and I was going to take my own life. She goes, I was on my way, and I ran out of gas. And she had to get help with her car, and someone drove her back home, and she was sitting at home that night, lonely, isolated, helpless, in despair. And that's when her phone rang. And it was Carol having a wrong number on the other line. She said, Carol, it was your conversations with me that gave me hope. It was the conversations that led me to a nearby church, and it was your conversations with me that led me to accept Jesus in my life. And for that whole year, Carol had no idea what God was doing. Just praying, God, use me. So, God, would you use me in some way? And all along, God was working behind the scenes to help Sue. There's another great, great quote. It says this, what we see God doing is never as good as what we don't see. What we see God doing is never as good as what we don't see. And I was thinking about this, and I thought about the resurrection of Jesus. People saw Jesus after he resurrected. They saw Jesus get hung on the cross. They saw Jesus die. They saw Jesus be put in a tomb. They saw the stone rolled away, but nobody saw the actual resurrection of Jesus rising from the dead in a horizontal position up. They saw him afterwards, but the greatest miracle in the world, no one saw. And I love that idea that what we see God doing is never as good as what we don't see. Even if it hurts to hear, even if we don't want to believe it, even if we feel like we're too far gone for God, God is at work in your life, even in this very moment, even if you don't see it. God is at work. Those of you who have been waiting for God to show up because you're disappointed or you're full of heartache, or you're grieving, or you're hurting, God is at work even now. The band can come on up. Come on up. I would say this, even if there's someone that you've written off, spiritually you think, gosh, they never have an interest in God. Don't write them off. Continue to pray for them. Continue to love them. Continue to invite them into things of God with you. But don't write them off because God is at work when we can't even see it. The prophet Isaiah put it this way. He's talking about God. Isaiah 55, verse 8. For my thoughts, this is God pretty much saying, for God's thoughts are not my thoughts. Neither are God's ways my ways, declares the Lord. I used to think that was God bragging, like, Rob, my thoughts are way above your thoughts, which they are. You don't understand me. But I think what it is saying partly is saying, you can trust me in the silence. You can trust me in the doubt. You can trust me when you don't have an answer, when there's no logic or all rationale says there's no way out. Then just know that my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. I am not limited to what you believe. You might not believe it, Rob. You might not believe it next chapter, but I, God would say, am not limited to what you believe and what you think. Because my ways and my thoughts, they're way higher than yours. And I'm doing something that you don't even see, but it's amazing and it's miraculous. But don't you think for a second that I'm absent from you when you don't get the answers or you don't get the timing that you're praying for. Sometimes I think, as human beings, we think, we're tempted to think when God is silent, well, it must be because I'm too messed up, or I'm too broken, or I'm too sinful. God is he's just spending time on more important people, on religious people, on better people. And I want to remind us just who the good news came to, the first people the good news came to, and that was to the group of those lowly shepherds that were corrupt and outsiders. They weren't even allowed to go into the temple. They were people that were not allowed to go into the church. They're outside of the church. And God comes to them first and says, hey, this is good news. It'll be for everybody, but I want to tell you guys first. So when you're tempted to think God's silence is because of you being too broken or too busted up, just know that that's not true. He comes to the shepherds first. And so maybe today, I don't know, maybe today you're thinking, Rob, I just don't know. I think I might be beyond reach or be beyond hope. And I want you to know that you're not today. That's the story of Christmas. Maybe you think it's because of something I've done or I'm beyond saving, or maybe it's something that you think compared to everybody else, your life is not worthy to be saved. But I want you to know that not only was there a sign given, there was a promise given. The angel says, this will be the sign. You will find him. Which means if you go and you put aside all your doubts, shepherds, if you will risk everything and you will go seek for the little child, you will find him, and this will be the sign. But if you don't go find him, if you don't go looking, you're not going to find him. And I love that the Christmas story is still true. If you are looking for God, if you are seeking God, you will find him. He's not hard to find. So that's God's promise to us this Christmas. You can still find him in the darkness, in the doubt, in the struggle. You can still find him in the grief. He is not gone. He is here, and he's doing something behind the scenes. Let's pray together. God, thank you for being a God that can be found, that you don't play hide and seek with us, that you want to be found, that you want to do a great work in our life and in this world. And so, God, thanks for having patience with us when we interpret your absence, your silence as absence. God, help us to have faith that you are doing something even greater in the times that we can't see. Father, as I look at my church family here, your sons and daughters, I know some of our stories. And I know that we have all gone through moments of feeling like you are not around and you do not care. If there's anyone here this morning that feels like that right now today, I pray that you would love on them extra special today, that you would embrace them, that you would fill whatever areas in their life that they need filled. And God, I pray that you would help us to continue to move forward and remind us of the Christmas story this week. Remind us that what we don't see you doing, you're doing something unbelievable. And may we sense your presence with us this week, God. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's stand together. We'll close with this great song. It's so apropos for what we're talking about, that God, he is Emmanuel with us.
Presence, we find our
Have a great week. Love you. Next Chapter Church. And I don't know what the next year holds, but I hope that we will always continue to believe that God is with us, that He truly has come to heal us and deliver us and to rescue us. And so I hope we experience that as we continue to go on. Let's pray. God, thank you for another Christmas together. Thank you for being faithful over the years with us as a community of faith. Father, thank you for being faithful in my own life and in our own lives. And Father, thank you for not getting angry and tired of us when we may question and doubt. And Father, I pray for the teenagers in this room that you would give them an extra measure of trust in you and faith in you, because as I look out, they've all have experienced a lot of different things already. And so I pray that you let them know that you are with them, that you have not forgotten them, that you have not forgotten their story, all that they've gone through. You are fully aware of, and you're doing a great work in them behind the scenes. So may you help them just to keep trusting. I pray that for us old folks too. And Father, this week, would you help us to love those, but more importantly, would you help us to take time to be in your presence, because it's in your presence that we find your strength, and we need it. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Have a great week. We'll see you Christmas Eve, hopefully. Merry Christmas Eve.